Welcome, everybody. This is Health Talk and sponsored by Community Medical Center. Dr. Daniel Beals, just call you Dan, right?
Dan, yeah.
Dr. Dan Beals joining us here this morning. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Excellent, excellent. So, haven't had a chance to meet you before. I have you on the show. Tell us a little bit about Dan Beals. Where'd you come from and how'd you get into being a pediatric surgeon?
Wow. Okay. So we've been here now.
Where do we begin?
we've been in Montana for about 10 months now, and absolutely loving living in Montana. So job wise, I came here. My last job was in Mobile, Alabama, which is quite a change.
Culture shock.
Yeah, culture shock. I was a chief of pediatric surgery there, and it's a big children's hospital. Before that, I was in Kentucky. Also, doing pediatric surgery and mm-hmm. stuff like that. I've been a pediatric surgeon almost 30 years now.
I was going to ask you, what is it about pediatrics? Obviously, you're passionate about that, so because that's what you do. How did you get involved in it?
Well, pediatric surgery, it's an interesting specialty when you think about it, because most specialties are organ specific. Okay, you think about a neurosurgeon; they're going to do brains and nerve stuff. Urologist does just kidneys and things like that. Pediatric surgery is really one of the only specialties that concentrates on surgery just on children. In a lot of ways, though, we do a lot of different surgeries on children, and that's kind of the difference. Is that, you know, I'll do urologic surgery and general surgery and thoracic surgery, but only on kids. With that, though, I'm also kind of the pediatric kind of holistic doctor, you know? So, you know, I look at the whole child and I'm able to take care of kind of all those different problems. So it's a cool specialty in that, you know, we're able to kind of take a broader picture of what's going on with the child. So we like that a lot.
What are some of the most common surgeries you perform?
Well, the number one most common pediatric surgery is inguinal hernia repair. So one out of about 20 kids has a hernia, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah, it's not like hernias in adults where you lift something that's too heavy and kind of rip something loose. These are congenital hernias. You were born with them. They're an easy fix. It's an outpatient surgery. If you had to look at numbers, pediatric hernia surgery probably would be the most common operation that I do. Like, you know, again, at this point, in the thousands that I've done over my career.
I can just imagine. I know John has small children, and my children were small at one time, and they all go through periods where they'll fall and hurt themselves or get a bad cut or break a leg or whatever. And, of course, as parents, we're frantic, you know, and we've got to get the care. We've got to get it right now. It's got to be the best. You know what I mean? And so they come to you, and there's usually a lot of frantic parents and grandparents saying, you know, Dr. Beals, you got to help us, right?
Well, listen, part of pediatric surgery is being able to take care of the parents also.
Here, take this and go lie down.
Well, you know, it's interesting because, you know, in my former career, I did a lot of teaching, so I had residents and stuff like that. And I could usually tell within about a day or so whether the resident was going to be able to make it on the service, not by their technical skill, you know, in the operating room, but whether they could actually interact with a parent very well or not. Because that's the key. You know, you can be the best surgeon in the world, but if you can't talk to people, it's not very useful.
You tried, I would imagine, you know, having never been in your position before, what you need to do is be able to have an air of calm, saying, okay, I'm just going to spread this calm throughout the room. Okay, child's in the hospital, in good hands, you need to relax, let us do our jobs. We'll be right out as soon as we can tell you more.
Exactly,
just,
right.
You know, have a cup of coffee, you know, pray with your pastor or whatever, and we'll take it from here, right?
You know, I've also taught in medical school, and one of the things that I teach medical students is that, you know, this idea of what we do is really pretty fantastic because, say for a hernia surgery, our most common surgery, I mean, I'm going to take that child, put them asleep, render them in a very vulnerable situation, actually take a knife to them. And so what's my contact with that parent? Well, they usually see me in the office. We have about a 15-minute consultation, and then we're getting ready for surgery. Wow, that's kind of crazy. Would you let somebody do that to your child within 15 minutes of meeting them? I mean, that's a huge responsibility, but also a huge privilege.
You have to be able to engender trust right away.
Exactly right. So, now it's interesting when you have kids. One of the best things, you know, is how does that whole interaction go? And so, you can't be just focused on the parents, and you can't be just focused on the kids. So a lot of times when I'll see kids, especially kids that are actually to the walking and talking age, I'll start talking with the kids first, try to get down on their level, because that makes them feel like they're in control of the situation.
Because my body you're cutting into,
exactly,
pal.
Right.
Yeah, right.
After that, I usually ask them if it's okay if I talk to their parents, which is almost always yes. And then we have a conversation with the parents. But you're exactly right. You have to be able to be confident, know what you're doing. You have to also be honest and be able to say, well, okay, that's not something I think we ought to do here. And especially working in a smaller community here, you know, I'm collaborating with Seattle Children's Hospital. And there are a few things that are so complex that, you know, the answer is that, well, I know exactly what you're talking about. I know how to do that. But that really needs to get done at a level, what we call a quaternary care hospital. And so that collaboration is really nice, because I can actually now go to Seattle Children's Hospital, do the surgery with their surgeons there, and then all the follow-up gets done here. So it saves an awful lot of moving back and forth and displacement.
So you actually travel to Seattle to do the surgery?
Yeah.
Oh,
so
wow.
that's the deal that we're working on now is even if I can't travel, I'm part of their division, both in the pediatric surgery and pediatric urology department, so that if they have surgery there, even if I'm not part of it, all their follow-up can be done here, which is really nice for the families.
So it's my understanding when you came on the scene in June, you were the only pediatric surgeon in Montana.
That's exactly right. There hadn't been, the previous pediatric surgeon had left about 2 years ago, and so there was zero pediatric surgery in Montana for a couple of years.
Well, so what is it about your field that it seems to be so specialized?
It is one of the most specialized surgical fields. There's probably 600 pediatric surgeons in the entire United States.
Wow. 600?
Yeah.
And so most towns don't have one.
Most towns do not. It's usually larger towns. And, you know, part of it is the ability to have a team around you that is able to take care of all these kids too. And so that usually is a larger hospital, larger town, because I need nursing staff especially trained to take care of kids. I need anesthesia doctors to put the babies to sleep that feel comfortable doing that. Just a whole host of things. Well, the interesting thing is that although Missoula is a small town and community is a small hospital, for some weird cosmic reason, all those little things happen to fit up. Mm-hmm. And I've told people here before, I have actually better pediatric anesthesia coverage than I had when I was at my last children's hospital.
What do you mean the payments on your, when you say coverage, what do you mean?
Well, the number of pediatric anesthesiologists and the expertise, the guys here I would put above,
oh, gotcha. You have better access
above,
to talent here. Is what
above
you're saying.
What I had at the children's hospital, the large children's hospital that I used to work at.
Wow.
So, and part of that's just people that live in Montana because they want to live in Montana. And so there's a whole bunch of really talented people that have decided, you know, this is where I want to live. This is what's going to happen. So
we're going to take a little break. Might we open the phones if folks have questions for
us? No, that'd be great.
Right. Dr. Dan Beals joining us here in studio, the only pediatric surgeon in Montana. If you have a question, give us a call. He'll be here until 9. 721-1290 is our number. We've got a brand new phone line, so we should try them out. 721-1290 is our number. We'd love to hear from you, and we'll be right back with more of Talk Back and Health Talk in a moment. Little doctor music to make Dr. Beals feel a little more at home this morning. All right, now, one question I wanted to ask you, Dr. Beals, is, I'm sorry, Dan.
Dan.
One thing I wanted to ask you about is the reason that there are so few pediatric surgeons is because, you know, a big fat guy like me, it's hard to miss. I mean, there's, you know, you know what I mean? But when you have a little tiny baby or maybe an infant or a 1 or 2 year old, you have to be really, really good at what you do to make sure everything's exact. I mean, the measurements have to be really, really exact, right?
Yeah, you know, if you think of like a a general surgeon or adult surgeon as kind of a cabinet maker. We're more watchmakers, so, you know, we're tiny sure, yeah. little things.
Right,
and,
right.
And really the heart and soul of pediatric surgery is taking care of those babies in the neonatal intensive care unit and the operations that we do on tiny babies. And that's, you know, again, that's a it's kind of a whole different feel to what you're doing when you're operating on a child that small.
So. You had mentioned that the most common surgery you do is hernias mm-hmm. on children. What are some of the other major things? I mean, do you see a lot of trauma? I mean, what percentage of what you see is expected surgery?
I would say probably 80% of what I see is expected surgery. Now, we don't have a trauma program at Community, but I'm happy to help with Level 2 Trauma Center at St. Pat's, and they do see quite a bit of trauma, and occasionally we'll have a patient transferred over for management. I'm also boarded in critical care, too, so that's, you know, that helps me be able to take care of these patients. So, you know, mostly I would say it's congenital problems, problems that you were born with, and that's one of the, again, differences between pediatric surgery and adult surgery. So there can be malformations of your intestines, of your lungs, of your urinary system. Those are all things that we would work on.
So there's not a lot of pediatric surgeons. I bet there's even less that are actually parents. What as a parent yourself, what would you tell other parents? Like what you've learned from your studies as a pediatric surgeon dealing with kids and other parents. What would you tell us about the way we look at our children? Do you think you view kids any differently now?
You know, I think it's you get a great appreciation of just how complex the human body is and how, you know, lucky we are when things go right. I think that's one of the things that I see. And it's interesting, especially when I'm working with Bardet Fawcett, our perinatologist. He actually takes care of babies inside the womb, and we sometimes collaborate on pre-delivery surgeries or coordinate surgeries that he does part before the baby's born and then I do part after the baby's born.
What is that like to do surgery when the child is still in the womb? Is that obviously you wouldn't do it if it wasn't safe, but I would imagine for the family it's a little scary. You're going to do what while what?
Exactly. So exactly. Well, you know, Dr. Fawcett's probably the person to talk to most about that. But we generally deal with things that are otherwise life-threatening to the fetus if we don't intervene. And so those are some of the things that we are sometimes have to do. The great news is that they're highly successful. And so we had a child just a few months ago where he had to do a procedure where he put a tube, a shunt, in to drain some fluid from the baby's lung. And then after the baby was born, then I get to take the shunt out. So, but that coordinated care is one of these cosmically crazy things that Community that we have. To have a person of Dr. Fawcett's ability here, as well as the ability to do those things, and then somebody to take care of those patients afterwards. Again, you know, our focus is to be at the level of a children's hospital, just like Seattle Children's Hospital. And so I think we're really hitting the mark with a lot of those issues.
So you already told us a little bit about what you've experienced with the team that you get to work with here. What about the types of cases you see? I mean, are the children coming in to you from Montana different than the children you saw in Alabama? Or is it pretty much the same wherever you go in the U.S.?
Kids are kids, right? It's
pretty much the same. Yeah, and especially with congenital problems, you know, doesn't seem to be a huge change, you know, given your geographic location. There may be a few things that are a little more common than others. You know, I think at this point, though, I'm seeing pretty much the same kind of things. We do see a lot of, you know, kids not necessarily for surgical problems, but also for some medical problems, too. And that just kind of rolls along with what we're doing.
Well, I was just thinking that in our work on this talk show, we have talked with, you know, hundreds of folks about various things to do with kids. And one of the things that is really at the mind, especially of educators and healthcare professionals, is that kids are not outside playing enough. They're not outside, you know, riding their bikes or, you know, doing whatever kids used to do when I was a kid.
Yep.
Now they're sitting playing video games, they're sitting watching this, they're sitting with their tablets. Are you finding in your practice that you're dealing with obesity more than in the past?
100%. I mean, I would say my practice in the deep south on the Gulf Coast, that was way more of a problem than it is in Montana. Montana actually has a pretty good record for getting out and doing things outside, so that's been a great surprise to me to see how well the kids are actually doing.
So as a pediatric surgeon, do you have some advice for parents out there here in Montana?
Well, you know, I would say keep doing what you're doing. Get outside, enjoy Montana. I mean, we came about 10 months ago to Montana, and, you know, what we tell everybody is that, well, we're Montanans. It just took us 50-something years to figure it out.
You won't be able to run for Senate, but you can do pretty much
right.
Anything else you want to do here.
Well, and we've survived our first winter, although most people will say this last winter was pretty wimpy.
Yeah,
but still, yeah. You know, you can't say you're a Montanan until you've been through one winter. So
I still say you have one more winter to go.
Okay. And I have to go, float the river.
Definitely.
And go rock hound. And those are the things people
tell me
I have to
do. You have to get
do.
Stuck in the snow a few times.
Yeah.
So
right.
On the top of a ski hill somewhere.
So one of the things that we've dealt with a lot recently was child abuse and neglect cases in Missoula. A lot of meth use. I mean, when these sorts of things happen, do these kids end up in your care?
Yeah, sometimes they do. For child abuse evaluation, sometimes I'll be called in to look and see how things are evaluated to make sure there's a good chain of custody or chain of evidence to be able to, you know, make sure those kids get taken care of.
So you must have to have a pretty good BS detector for some of these parents, right?
Yeah. Well, again, it comes with 30 years of practice. So you get to know things pretty well. So
you know what things look like when you see them.
Yeah. And that's, you know, especially when you're talking with child abuse cases, the number one thing that we look for is when the story doesn't add up or the story changes.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, again, we're not the ones in charge of any kind of prosecution. We're just the ones gathering facts. And so you just keep it on a professional level, make sure you take care of the kid. Don't worry about that.
A very important part of that whole procedure.
Sure.
All right. Well, we're going to take a little break. Come right back. By the way, lines are open. If you have a question for Dr. Beals, give us a call. 721-1290 is our number, and we're coming right back. Okay, we are back on Health Talk. We have a question from Facebook, Joe.
Yeah, Katie wants to know, how old do you work up to? I mean, when is a kid no longer a kid anymore?
Well, for the most part, it's the same as for general pediatrics, so 18 to 21 years old. There are a few exceptions to that. If you have some lifelong pediatric problem, many times we'll continue to see those kids, sometimes even a little older than that. But typically that's when we do the handoff, is somewhere between 18 to 21.
And she wants to also know, do you deal with burns?
So, yeah, that's something that's kind of evolving right now. Most of the time when you look at, the American Burn Association has a criteria of patients that need to be transferred to burn units. For care. And so that's pretty well set for pediatric patients. But there's a large number of pediatric burns that are less than that criteria, and we're certainly happy to take care of those. That's not a problem. And we can certainly take care of burn patients that have been treated at burn centers and now need aftercare. They don't necessarily have to go out of town for that.
Yeah, we have about 2 minutes left in the program, believe it or not. You're almost done.
Yeah.
You did a great job, by the way.
Thanks.
Real quickly, advice for parents out there on boundaries for their kids, keeping them safe. We're coming into summer, you know, we're going to get into accidents and falls and things like that. I don't want to put them in a bubble, but how do you keep them safe?
Well, use common sense, number one. You need to monitor what your kid's doing because, again, they're kids, and so they'll get crazy ideas and think that they can jump that ditch or whatever. And the other is, go ahead and do the safety devices. They really do need to wear their helmets when they're on four-wheelers. It's a huge problem. Four-wheelers, you know, are hard to manage if you're younger because they weigh more.
Right.
And the biggest problems I see with those is either head injuries, where they get thrown off of a four-wheeler, or the four-wheeler flips and they can't get from underneath it. And then they get crushed. And so, again, just monitor what your child's doing. Make sure that it's a safe activity. But again, I don't want them to not do those things. I mean, that's why you live in Montana.
Right. How about being out on the water?
Same thing. Life preservers, you know. You got to wear life preservers if you're out on the water. Especially, you know, as the river's coming up and starting to run off, you need to stay out of the water, you know, unless you have a specific goal, or you're at a lake or something like that. Mm-hmm. So
okay, we got about a minute left in the show. So if folks want to get in touch with your department over there at Community Medical Center, how do they do that? I mean, you're in the pediatric. Obviously, you have your own office and your own section. So is there a number, special number for that?
Yep, there's a special number for that. And, of course, you asked me, and I don't have it right now.
Well, just call the main number, right?
Yeah,
728-4100 is the number. And that'll get you to my office. And on the website, we're on the website, too, for Community Medical.
Excellent. So. Well, it's been a pleasure meeting you.
Yeah, thanks. I appreciate it.
We look forward to having you back, and let us know when you get up to Rock Creek and do some fishing.
Hey, we'll get some big ones.
Right. He could be catching the big ones.
Oh.
That's
yeah, then we'll have you again on Friday for the fishing show.
Hey, I'll go for that.
Dr. Beals, thanks so much.
Thank you.